several evenings, Arthur Hicks was there, and we got talking, just sort of more or less the three of us from what I can recall. There was one bit that they were then talking in terms of trying to do an extension, which we hadn't then got before pre-78. And another bit you might not know, one suggestion that Arthur Hicks was coming up with was to take, well, where the bar doors are now, and go straight out as far as the road on a pier so that you drove underneath and arrived in the dry, and the bar and the lounge was out over the top. Didn't come to anything, but that was one of the ideas that was mooted. But the other thing was, because it was just to take the mickey out of Dick, pull his leg about it, because we had the old fire escape with a flagpole on it, and we used to put the Union flag up for the carnival. So as it was getting near time for us to go home, sunset, we used to say, "Dick, sunset!" I used to go out and take the flag down, and Dick walked downstairs, stood in the car park and saluted. But he gradually talked about his life, mentioned bits of when he was in the Navy during the war, and apparently, I think, from best of my recollections, he was on a destroyer called Fire Drake. You might be able to look it up, you know, and check on it somewhere, I don't know. And he was only sort of a junior seaman, just to get some sea time in before he went to officer training school, and he came in, I think, to Chatham one day, and I suppose the petty officer said, "You show this bloke where you're bunking, get your gear and clear off." And he went to King Alfred at Hove, the training school. And when he'd finished his training, he said they were all shuttled off all over the world to various places, and he and some others were told, "Right, you, your party X, get to Scarpa Flow rapidly." So I don't know how long it took, but then when they got to Scarpa Flow, went aboard the flagship, and the officer of the watch said, "No, you're not wanted here, you're wanted on that one over there. And it's just sailing, so get a move on." They got to it, got on board and sailed, and then found out that they were heading for Canada with Winston Churchill to meet up with President Roosevelt in, I think it's Placentia Bay.
And that was the Prince of Wales, wasn't it?
There was the Prince of Wales. And it was the founding of the Atlantic Charter. And Dick and his colleagues, from what I can understand of it, were there to encode this thing for sending back. Because he was able to quote the first few lines of the Atlantic Charter. And I don't know what happened much after that, but at one time he was somewhere on the West African coast. Something I saw on television only a couple of nights ago makes me think it was probably Sierra Leone. It was where the convoys used to change all their code books, and he used to have to go out and climb aboard and change the code books, depending which way they were travelling. I think one time he had to go out to something like the Queen Mary or the Queen Elizabeth, and they dropped a rope from a door hanging out, up, climbing up the side of the Queen, and he had no head for heights, so I don't know how he did it. And then on another occasion, they looked out and the Prince of Wales was anchored off, and he shot out there. Any chance of getting on, switching with someone? So you can find someone to swap with you. Yeah, you can come with us. So they looked ashore and didn't fancy it, so he had to go back to work. And the ship sailed, and a few weeks later, she was sunk by the Japanese.
In Singapore?
Yeah.
So that was a lucky escape.
Obviously, yeah. He didn't have his name on it at that time, obviously.
No, quite, yeah.
And then the next I can remember him talking about, he was in Ceylon, Colombo, in Ceylon, I think it was Colombo, on Mount Batten's staff. And these relatively junior officers, on occasion, a select few were separated around, and they had to go to dinner with Sir. And he said they went to this magnificent house, and they were milling around in this hallway, and this huge, and suddenly Sir appeared at the top of the staircase to make an entrance, and they were like to be nice to Sir. And then the war finished, and they were rushed to single the vacuum and take over. To, and I don't know what sort of building it was, some large scale building, and they took it over, I presume, as other headquarters or as an officer's mess, I'm not sure which. And of course, the junior officer, you're down here, you know, the lower floors, so we'll have the penthouse, which was fine by them, because by this time the junior officer trained, the lifts weren't working, there was no lifts. So I don't know how it went on, but that was the sort of, that was the tale that I, as far as I can recall it.
So he had quite an eventful war.
Sounds like it, yeah.
And then he came
back. Well, not too dangerous. No, not too dangerous, but eventful.
He got around it.
Yeah.
And then he came back to Hastings, became a solicitor.
Yep. And I don't know how he did it. He was a solicitor. And he was, the, I believe, is the recorder.
Yeah.
When there was sort of a...
It's a sort of a, he was a lay judge.
He was the police prosecutor. He was chairman of the Stables Trust. He was chairman of the Theatre Guild. He was chairman of the Haslians. And at one time, he was also president of NODA, the National Association of Drama Groups.
Astonishing, astonishing. And it was very much him, or his sort of personality, that kept the idea of the Stables alive.
Yeah, yeah. At the time of the 10th birthday, I always remember it was February time, they got a lot of it planned. And he was very good. Not many of them, the management do it, came down and talked to the stage crew who were working that evening on the set. And said, oh, we've got plans for the 10th birthday and some of it is, it's going to be like this. And he said, oh, we're going to have a lunch at the Queen's on the Sunday, and Max Hadrian's coming on Wednesday, and on Friday we've got a film, and Saturday we've got the Toronto Ballet coming. So what's the film going to be? Oh, we haven't decided that. So I said, well, you realise it's the 6th of June, that Friday, and it's the 25th anniversary of D-Day. Why don't we get the Longest Day? Wonderful idea. We'll do that. So they booked Longest Day. And then when it came to the time, about a week before, they pulled it and let us have it. So we didn't have the Longest Day. Toronto Ballet Tour didn't come off.
Oh, dear.
But we had the London Contemporary Dance Company come down. And whenever I mention this to Sue Marshall, who does the contemporary dance group here, she said, I cannot remember the name of the chap that was the head of it. And she said, so I said, oh yeah, he was here. And she sort of, fancy meeting him. And that was the way, you know, we've had loads of them in. I can remember coming into this dressing room and finding Lady Isabel Barnett in this magnificent fur and leather coat, sitting on this bench, having a fag, and chatting to us.
We're coming up to our 50th birthday.
Mm-hmm.
Or rather, the theatre's coming up to its 50th birthday. Both you and me are long past our 50th birthday. What are your thoughts about the theatre as it approaches 50 years? Because when it first started, lots of people were sceptical that it could ever get off the ground. But here we are, coming up to 50 years. What do you think about what has happened in the past and where are we going in the future?
Holy whack. Well, thankfully it's still here. Hopefully it will be for another 50 years. And that we're building... We've built firm foundations to keep it going. It all depends on the people that come into it. We need... Well, we always need more help. I mean, the stage crew, we send out letters for a rota, for instance, to help. About every 3 months we send it out. Can you, you volunteer to help? Because we get it off the computer. You volunteer to help. Can you on any of these dates? And on occasion we sent out about 85 letters with stamped addressed envelopes for returning these letters. And we got the usual dozen to 15 back. and it makes you wonder why people do it. I got a list, a printout just last week of how many volunteered to help backstage according to the membership. You know, you join and you tick the boxes. I think it's 105 at the moment, and we're lucky if we can get a dozen to 15 replies. It's a hard core of people.
And but hopefully new
they
people...
They all say, oh, you're putting people off. How? I don't know. We've never... How you can put someone off that you've never met? It does rather confuse me.
Yeah.
But this is a thing that we've always... The stage crew have always been accused of, putting people off. And we bend over backwards to try. We phone them, we write to them, we've invited them to come down and meet us when we're, you know, at a time to meet us. And people have agreed, oh yes, I'll be down. And they don't even bother to bring up to apologise, they can't make it, they just don't bother. Don't know why.
Well, strangely enough, I've received those things in the past.
You're one of those who never replied.
I've never replied because I've always thought that anybody who wants me would ask me.
Oh,
they do.
Don't be specially asked, don't you?
No.
I wish I could be.
No, this is the point. No, everybody knows, people know the people who are prepared to do things, don't they?
Yeah, old magazines do it.
Yes, right, yes. That's true enough. That's true. Yeah, that's true.
Don't tell me you've run out of ideas.
I've run out of ideas, yes. I've done what to say now.
What about the professionals that we've had?
Yes, true, yeah. What about professionals?
So the hardest one was a show called Marilyn. I think it was in about 75, I can't remember. We can find it if you need to know. It was a Friday night show, one night stand. It was before it opened in London, which rather caused me some complaints because they put the advertising up with pictures and all sorts, and then put a big sign across it, prior to London. And I said, what have I done to upset people? You want to get rid of me? They haven't seen it that way, but still, twisted. Anyway, the stage manager, we had to take time off from work to do this show because the stage manager arrived on Thursday lunchtime, and she was South Africans, very South Africans, and we imagine just out of drama school or something like that, because she got these huge sheets of paper with coloured circles on for all the lights that she wanted, which we haven't got all that many, and we spent the afternoon phoning school teachers up that we knew had got lights in their school halls, can we borrow them? We borrowed some lamps, we were working away. And we worked through from midday till, I think it was 3 o'clock in the morning, rigging lighting. Then I had to give her a lift to where she was staying, which wasn't very far from me, it was in Elswood Road. Sue Pivers, as she is now, put her up. And you can imagine 3 o'clock in the morning trying to find an address that you didn't know, and she'd never been there. Eventually we saw Sue standing at the front door. And then we started again at 9 o'clock next morning. God. 9 o'clock that morning, and at about 11 the company arrived, and he didn't want to upset his stage manager with lighting, and he wanted to check it all out. So, and in those days the lighting was worked from up on the fly gallery, and bit of luck we did have the two preset board, not the old faders. And I was trying to work lighting to her instructions and adapt them to his instructions that were being passed to me for signals from George. Yeah, it was great fun. And then we had to rehearse bits of it. He had a part where he wanted the lights to flash on and off in time with the music. And he got the girl playing Marilyn to do the piece several times. Because I wasn't quite in time, let's get it right. Well, that's fine, because I had two hands to work two faders up and down in time with the music. When it came round to doing the show, which we never did a live rehearsal we'd only did the bits and a few bits and pieces, I found that I had to use one hand to work two faders up and down in time with the music, at the same time reading my lighting plot and resetting the next one. Then we reached a point where I said to the stage manager, was up there beside me, right, I'm ready for Q25, something like that. Oh, you should only be at Q20. I thought, well, I can only do a cue when you tell me to do it, so it's your funeral. And then we got reached this point where, oh, lighting must be right at this point, whatever happens. And it was all sort of pinks and purples. So I thought, well, it can be with Marilyn Monroe. I wondered if it was the famous nude calendar that she'd done. So I have to have a look at this bit over the top and look down on stage. And the girl playing it was in the copy of the semi-rich dress, the white dress, all the way through. And I looked over and she was laying centre stage with her head on the curtain line towards the audience, feet upstage on her back. And then these four fellas came on, one after another from stage left, walked up to her, sort of knelt beside her and rolled over and walked off the other side of the stage. Which seems all right on the face of it, till you found out that they were wearing masks, gauntlets, belts and nothing else. And one of the ladies in the audience is reputed to have said, three Gentiles and a Jew. But I cannot verify that because I was up above looking down and couldn't see. And in the end, it was only an hour and a half show, continuous running tape with a backup tape. Don't know how we did, got it going if it stopped still. And time we finished, we went up the other end for a drink. And then we ran into the station and came back for a drink to unwind. And then time I left, I worked here afterwards, I'd done 29 hours in a 35-hour period. And having had a very short night, Thursday to Friday, I didn't sleep at all on Friday night. No. I was so tired.
Yeah.
And at one point, just before the show started, I was up in the old bar, going through the notes with the stage manager, and Sybil came up the stairs, and I was conscious of her looking at me, and she was sort of shuffling people away from me, because it was people were getting to come in, you know. And you could see we came backstage, and I remember walking over into the corner, stage manager's corner, and there was a chap sitting there on a stool, and I just sort of pushed him off and sat down and carried him. And I realised afterwards, if anybody had spoken to me, I would have burst into tears, I was that far gone. But we got through it, and it was well received.
And then, of course, came a great day when it was decided, or when finally you were able to do the extension.
Indeed, yes, with Mum here. The Queen Mum.
Queen Mum.
Yeah. And in those days, I was back working locally, so it's a lot easier for me. And I said to my then governor, look, I'm all right if I have this, I think it was on a Wednesday.
I
think. Any chance that I could have the afternoon off? So what's that? I said, well, we've got this thing on the theatre and the Queen Mum's coming. Have the day! So, thanks very much. So I finished up down here at about 8 o'clock in the morning, escorting the police around.
Oh yeah, to check everything out.
It wasn't too bad in those days, because these were in civilian clothes, and the leader of them had been down once before. We went under stage, and they said, we haven't got to search this lot, have we? And the chap was in charge. No, he says, I was down here the other day, it looks exactly the same, shut the lid. And we went all round searching everything. And we had an old furniture lorry at the back for scenery. Not interested in that. So went home, had some lunch, cleaned up and changed, you know, to clean clothes. The council had reserved the down the road car park for us so that we could park in there to keep this all clear, which was good of them. And got back here, bumped into this police officer, a